Okay, thank you. Lori is going to introduce tonight's speaker.
Yes, we have a virtual presentation tonight by Guy Foster, who is the he is the supervisory hydrologist for the USGS at the Marine Systems Branch of the USGS New York Water Science Center, based in Troy. And Guy comes to us because back in April, the Water Use Resource Management Committee had some questions about the discontinuance of certain parameters of the Berryville stream gauge. And we wrote a letter on April 23rd to the USGS to inquire about that. And in response to the letter we got back, they graciously offered to give us a program on it so we could get more information. So not only do we have Guy here to give the presentation, but we also have his Pennsylvania counterpart at the USGS, who is Tom Ruby, also virtual. So Guy, if you're ready, we'll share the screen and you can get started.
Yeah, I'm all set. I assume everybody can hear me. We got a couple thumbs up there. All right, got some head nods. Let me go ahead and share my screen. So thank you all for having me this evening. I'm going to give a fairly brief high-level presentation on USGS, you know, a little bit of our history, a little bit on stream gauging, what it is, how we do it. I'm not sure across the audience here of the familiarity. Feel free to ask me questions at the end. I can see everybody here on the OWL, so if somebody raises their hand, I won't be able to know your name, but at least I can potentially call on, you know, and answer, hear your question. Everybody should be able to see the presentation right now, I assume. All right, gotcha. So like I said, my name is Guy Foster. I work in the New York Water Science Center. I oversee our data collection and monitoring networks statewide in New York. We'll talk a little bit about USGS. You know, we are, sometimes people are not sure who we are. We're called the wrong name, U.S. Geological Society. A lot of times we're more related to volcanoes, earthquakes, and maps than we are water, even though water is probably our biggest appropriated program as an agency. We are a Department of the Interior agency, just like our Park Service counterparts. We were established back in 1879, so we've been around for a while. Our mission is to provide the nation with reliable and impartial science. We are the only pure science agency in environmental science agency in the Department of the Interior. We have very, very little regulatory authority, and that kind of is one of our important points, that, you know, a lot of folks will come to us for data across a breadth of topics because we are not here to tell anybody how to regulate anything. For the most part, there are some very few specific exceptions to that. And I will talk this, you know, one point is our data collection is done in cooperation with multiple agencies, both federal, local, and state. I am going to dig in a little bit because that's related to Berryville and what happened to Berryville. And we'll get to that near the end of the presentation and won't be too long. So, you know, y'all can get on with various business. We have been in the stream gauging business since 1889. So we have been at this for quite a while. We started in out west in New Mexico in the original hydrologic surveys. And we've come a long way in the almost 150 years since then. Our stream gauges, I assume you know, we're having this meeting because most of you are at least familiar with our stream gauging program at a very basic level. Most of our stream gauges, they're, you know, pretty, you know, simple looking metal boxes sometimes these days on the side of a stream. Some of our older ones are more heavily constructed with, you know, brick and stone and whatnot. You know, these days they more look like utility boxes than anything else. They kind of blend in sometimes. What a stream gauge does, whether it's using, you know, a float tape or a pressure system or a radar, all a stream gauge generally does is collect stage data, which is the height of water above the datum. We collect it every and serve it to the public every 15 minutes to an accuracy of 1/200ths of a foot. So 0.02 feet is our accuracy standard that we publish and we send out to the web. We record it every 15 minutes and we send it to the web, sometimes every 15 minutes, sometimes once an hour, just depends on the location. All that data is sent via satellite or cell phone. More and more, we're using cell phones and Iridium satellites. We're even using Starlink as the technology progresses. But that's your basic stream gauge. All it really does is it collects the level of the stream, the height of the stream over time to a very high accuracy. What we do with that information to give everybody discharge, discharge being the volume of water moving over at a certain rate, you know, we measure it in cubic feet per second, is we have staff go out anywhere from 4 to 8, give or take, times a year to measure discharge. We measure discharge using a variety of methods, acoustic methods. We have actual mechanical current meters that we'll sometimes use. We actually, you know, we have some more visual optical methods that we're starting to develop. And our staff will go out there and they'll measure multiple times a year and start relating that discharge measurement to the stage that's being recorded at the station. Over time, we develop a rating curve. So, you know, anybody in the room who's got a background in civil engineering or, you know, or you know, this kind of, you know, engineering type stuff, it's pretty basic. We relate that over time. Usually the streams are pretty stable. So that, you know, even though that can change over time, and we have some record, some streams that have had a stable control, stable discharge rating for decades. Others shift routinely. It just depends on the site, depends on the geology. It depends on, you know, how many beavers decide to go out and, you know. So we go out and we create these ratings. And once the ratings are created, we serve that computed discharge to the web at the same periodicity as we do stage. And we maintain that rating. It's like a model until the gauge no longer has funding. We do have a lot of new technology. So, you know, as we move forward, a lot of the traditional gauge houses where we have, you know, these boxes are getting smaller and smaller. We're using optical technology now. Our need to go out and measure is you know, maybe not going to be as much in the future because, you know, folks can go out with a cell phone and take some velocity, take some video, and that can be used by our staff to develop a discharge measurement if we have the metadata on the stream. And there's other new technologies out there. So, you know, USGS, as well as, you know, we've been doing this for a long time, but we're not necessarily doing it the same way. And we're moving, you know, our technologies forward. We do collect other types of data. I actually have a background in water quality. So, you know, temperature and conductance at Berryville, we collect temperature. We used to collect conductance for a period of time. All these different data types had different uses. We have other gauges in the Delaware Basin, Upper Delaware, where we collect everything from, you know, temperature, conductance, all the way to algal fluorescence, which is related to potential harmful algal blooms, dissolved organic matter. We even have the capability to measure in real time nitrate. So, and then there's more technologies, more sensors out there. These are the ones we do really well. And so, you know, what is that? And we take all this information, we have staff who run these sites, full-time professional data collectors. You know, we sometimes have students, but for the most part, all of our stations are run by full-time professionals who make careers out of doing this work. All this data gets served up to you, into the World Wide Web via our National Water Information System. I have a link there, and I will share this presentation with the links afterwards with the group. But we have our National Water Dashboard, which has all the sites nationally, that you can just click on the site, click on the data type you want, and look at a graph and download the data, get a history of the site, know how long we've been there, basic stream stats for each site, so you can see if we're, you know, high, low, you know, average flows, those kind of thing. All that served. We quality assure the data. So, you know, a lot of the data, when it comes out, we call it provisional. And then over time, our staff go back and review based on our field checks and calibration checks. And they will go in and approve the data at a later time to, you know, and that gives us this final USGS stamp of approval, you know, if it needed to be corrected because of fouling or shifts or whatnot. So that is basic stream gauging 101 in 5 minutes or less. Does anybody have any questions on this before I kind of move on into... All right. I don't see any hands.
No questions.
I have one quick question. What significant changes have you seen, like, over the last few decades?
That's a big question. That really depends on the region. It depends on where we're talking about. You know, if we're talking about the Delaware, I'm not prepared to talk about that, but we can certainly follow up with the experts here in our office who can. You know, one thing I am going to talk about next is USGS has invested specifically in the Delaware Basin with a next generation water observing system. That's been active since 2018. We have a lot of higher technological kind of bar for a lot of these sites where we're feeding more complex models. We're doing more analysis, historical, maybe answer your questions specifically. The coordinator for that basin actually works here in our office, but he's on leave this week. I was going to have him join me on this presentation. And again, it might be would help to answer the question specifically. But I'll have his contact. I have his contact information at the end. But was there any other questions there? I'm sorry if I can't really answer your question too. Okay. How accurate is the Stilesville gauge? I see that question here. Stilesville, we had some issues with specifically collecting discharge. And we made some changes to the location of that gauge. I can get the site operators in contact with the person who had that question there. But we specifically had some changes we recently made because of the challenges of gauging because of algae and plant growth. We had a bunch of weeds grow in the summer that completely choked the channel. So I hope I answered that question. So moving on, the next generation water observing system is something that USGS is an appropriated funded effort where we are, you know, this is one of several basins across the US where we're gauging up with more advanced technology and providing that data back to the public. I'm assuming some of you, if not all of you, might be somewhat familiar with the NGUS Delaware Basin. There are links, and I have contact information if you're looking for more information about that. So let me get to how gauges are funded, since this is related to what sparked off this talk in you know about Berryville. Our water science centers are funded by three main sources. Two on this slide, and I'll talk about the other one on the next slide. Two of the main sources are federal, both appropriated. So when we say appropriated dollars, that's when we get money through a congressional budget that says, here, USGS, you are to do a thing. It's just like Department of Defense or any other bureau or agency in the federal government. And that would be part of the annual budget of the US. The other way we get, second way we get money is through federal partnerships, you know, like with Park Service, Corps of Engineers, EPA, and that's interagency agreement. So they're taking their appropriated dollars and giving it to us for stream gauges. And this in the water portion of USGS is kind of unique. In fact, in a lot of the government, we are fairly unique because we are only about 35%, and that's for New York. It changes depending on the state and the center. We're only about 35% federal funding overall. And of that, it's even a smaller percent that's actually appropriated by Congress to us. Most of our funding, the other 65%, comes from state, local, and county partners through joint funding agreements. So, you know, somebody identifies a need that they need stream flow information, whether that be at the state or a county or a town or even academic institutions, they will come to us. We'll discuss what their needs are, where to put the gauge, and we'll go into a funding agreement with that entity. We have hundreds of joint funding agreements because our stream gauging network nationally is about 10,000 gauges. We have about 400, you know, 350 to 400 here in New York, and it is a, you know, a complete patchwork of different funding cooperators. So, you know, we have. I tried to take some of the logos from the local areas there in Upper Delaware, but obviously there's some that are from other places in New York. Berryville itself, you know, I'll talk about the next slide, is actually funded through Pennsylvania DEP, and not New York. There's a little bit of background for that, and Tom's on the call here. He can also talk to the Pennsylvania cooperators. We price our gauges based on a number of factors. They're, you know, the initial estimated replacement costs, how much it costs for the equipment to install, the types of data you're collecting. You know, a lot of the cost into our gauges involve the operations and maintenance costs, which go to the salary of the technicians. You know, we have a fairly complex way to cost. We are not profit. I mean, we're a federal agency, so, you know, it's not like we cost things so we can make a return. We have to zero at the end of the year, like every other federal agency. So, you know, our gauges are based on, our gauge costs are based on what it actually costs to get the information, the approved final information to the funding partner, and also plug it into our larger network, right? So one of the nice things about, you know, USGS science is a stream gauge in New York is comparable to a stream gauge somewhere else. So there's bigger science, bigger models can be, you know, they all feed into the larger network and all the possibilities and all the potential uses of that data that come from that, whether that be flood prediction at a local scale, regional scale, whether it be, you know, drought monitoring, whether it be just, you know, DOTs use our data to come up with regional statistics to design culverts for or design bridges. So, you know, all the way down to kayakers and trout fishermen who use our data for, you know, planning what to do on their weekend, whether it's worth going out to fish or not. So getting to Berryville specifically, some of our gauges are funded through multiple entities. So, you know, sometimes USGS, we do have some small amount of appropriated dollars that we can use as matching funds to help offset, or, you know, it's one of the, you know, a cooperator will pay a certain amount of the gauge, 80, 90%. We'll cover the other bit if we have the funds available, and that, you know, to help plug it into our network and some other reasons. Delaware River, Berryville, it was installed in 2018. It was the stage, the elevation information, the temperature was paid for by the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection, but discharge and the conductivity, specific conductance, which is, you know, basically the saltiness of the water, was paid for by our NGWAS program. This last year, NGWAS had to make some decisions and cuts to reallocate internal funds. And the decision was made by the NGWAS team that they were going to stop discharge at Berryville and reallocate those funds to some other items that they needed. And specifically technological research, I think, is where they ended up retuning those dollars. It was there for a couple of years, for 5-6 years, and then it was just cut as part of, you know, the NGWAS program. I'm sure that some of you wondering, like, how much was that cost? It's generally, the discharge is generally between 10 to 11,000 per year, the discharge element alone. The conductance, I think, is about 67,000 a year annually. And that's essentially what happened with Berryville. So with that is the end of my presentation. So I can try to take some questions if anybody has any at this point.
We have a question up on the board. The woman had her hand up.
Christine?
Yeah. So I'm a resident of Berryville and represent the town of Highland on the UDC. And I'm just wondering, what does that mean for us? I mean, obviously we're getting the data from all the other gauges and stuff, but I mean, it's hard not to feel like this is a loss. Maybe you can help me figure that out.
I mean, there's no reason why, you know, partners can't come together and fund and, you know, to re-stand up the data. We just need the funding to do it, because NGWAS is no longer going to pay for it through allocated means. So, I mean, there's no reason why we can't find other partners to fund the gauge. We just can't currently do it because we don't have the funding to do so. So it just comes down to funding. I don't know if that helped. Does that help answer your question?
Would the USGS help us find that funding in those other places that maybe you're familiar with?
Well, generally the way we do it is, like, you know, we can talk with, you know, if there's interest with local federal partners, be it, you know, I don't want to speak for any other entity or agency here. I mean, but, you know, whether it be Park Service or the Berryville itself or a group of that, I mean, a group of local entities to put into their budgets the O&M, we're happy to reach out and, you know, provide costs, provide information. Usually these kind of things, they need to go back to town city councils or get into, you know, annual budgets. And, you know, we're not part of that. And, you know, we people who generally come to us, we provide the information and it's up to them to fund. We are not, you know, we tend not to get out and be salesmen for this kind of thing, but we're happy to do things like this, like come in and present what we do, how we do it, what it costs, what the benefits are. And that's kind of, I think, a lot of times how our gauges get funded. But we typically won't, you know, I'm happy to reach out to locals. Like sometimes we do have a program called the Federal Priority Stream Gauges, which is an attempt by Congress to fund a more dense national stream flow network. And a lot of times we've reached out to people at locations, towns, counties, and said, hey, you know, do you have interest in a gauge in this area? You know, and frankly, a lot of times, sometimes they come back with us and we get a stream gauge in, and sometimes it's just not in local, you know, budgets. But I think the best way to do it, and I know I'm kind of growing on here, is for the local communities to, you know, come together and either, you know, talk to their town council or equivalent local government, or reach out to the state agencies like the Department of Environmental Conservation or local federal agencies and ask, hey, we'd like a stream gauge here. We'd like to work with USGS. So there's many ways. I guess there's many paths to get this, you know, get funding in place with us to run a stream gauge.
Yeah, thanks for doing this presentation tonight. I represent Tustin and Upper Delaware Council. I also run a fishing guide service on the Delaware, so I use the gauges every day, just about. I just had two questions. One about Berryville. You said it was installed in 2018, but was there a gauge there prior to that that was maybe older, and then there was a newer one installed in 2018, or was that the first gauge on that
rig? Yeah, we had daily discharge values back there, I think, to the 60s, where there was there is historical data there.
I think one of the gauges in Barrington was above the Lackawaxen River on the Grassy Swamp Road, if I remember right.
That's different. That's the Kinsale gravity.
But it was called Barrington.
Yeah, very well. The other one right, it's not that far away. But yeah, we used
that
to.
Function one yet?
Yeah, that one should be on. Yeah, the Loxa. That one should be on and working and funded. When I looked in creating this presentation, I went through the gauges in the area.
All right, thank you. And then,
excuse me, I have a question. Hold on, I'm sorry, my hand is up. What is the cost of the gauge?
Well, for Berryville specifically, the discharge element is about $10,000 to $11,000 a year. You know, usually the gauges as a whole, the whole thing, if a single entity was funding a stream discharge only stage discharge gauges, they're generally between $18,000 and $22,000 a year. In this case, Pennsylvania DEP is already paying for the stage element. So the discharge element is about, you know, like I said, $10,000 to $11,000 a year. And is what the cost is.
So this is a yearly cost that has to be recurring. Otherwise, if it's not recurring, what happens to the gauge?
We generally shut it down. So we're not allowed to work without a funding agreement in place. That it just goes for any federal agency. So once the funding agreement's in place, in this case, again, it's really kind of easy because the stage data is already working. The infrastructure is already in place. It's just a matter of getting the discharge data, the rating redeveloped and republished. So from our perspective, all kind of the hard stuff's done. We just need to reactivate that particular data type. And
when does this have to be done by, if one should choose to fund it?
It's up to the funding agency. Usually we're at the whatever group is funding us, it usually goes by their fiscal year. So, you know, like for instance, with the state of New York, agreements we have the state of New York, their fiscal year is April, begins on April 1. So a lot of their agreements will start April 1 and go through March 30th. And that's when they renew it. And, you know, we can have multiple year agreements. It just depends. Like some local municipalities will have like laws that say they can't enter into agreement longer than 1 year at a time. And other folks can go into multiple year agreements. It all depends on your local rule. So
Thank you.
This is Fred. I have a question.
Yeah.
My video's not working, so my camera. Why don't we get New York City to fund it? I mean, they're pretty much responsible on what these gauges detect, because it's all their flows that are conditioned upon the gauges.
Yeah, and New York City
pays. Do they pay for any of this?
They pay for a lot of gauges in the Catskills and over in the Crotons. We have a fairly dense network paid for by New York City DEP in the area, mostly related to the New York City water supply. You know, so we do a lot of groundwater well monitoring related to the aqueducts. And we have many stream gauges up on the upper Esopus and the Catskills and the various tributaries, all the way at the lower Esopus River, and then the various reservoirs and outlets on the east of Hudson. We also do significant monitoring paid for by New York City and the five boroughs, a lot of groundwater monitoring there. So we actually have quite a few stream gauges funded by New York City.
I just have one more question, Guy. Your website was reformatted within the last few years for most of the gauges. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious, I mean, you're obviously familiar with that, but still to this day, if I open up the gauge, it loads the old format for maybe 5 seconds, and then it switches to the new format. Mm-hmm. So I just was curious if you've experienced that as well on your end. And then also, I guess that's all, but the new format is arguably a little tougher to use than the old, so it's kind of interesting in so-called improvement, in my opinion. But
for what it's worth, there's quite a bit of controversy internally here in USGS as well as to because those kind of things are done, you know, at kind of the national scale, and those of us in the science center just kind of got to roll with it. I don't have that where it kind of holds. I use the national one, the map, to get to the sites. And so I don't have that same instance, but I can report that through our IT chains and see if there's any, you know, any input or resolution they might have for that. Because it's the first time I've heard of that happening. But as far as the utility of the new sites, like I said, I you're not alone in that, including for those of us who work.
Okay, one other follow-up really quick. Yeah. You mentioned that there's detections for like certain algae blooms and things. Yeah. And it's sort of along with Jeff's question there on the screen as well. At what point are you, you know, you're like, okay, you're picking up this algae bloom, and are you going to talk to local authorities about it? Because I mean, personally, I've noticed a lot about a new algae in the river just recently. Mm-hmm. As the water's been warming, and I don't think, I mean, maybe the Calicoon gauge has that set, mm-hmm. that detector. I'm sorry, I don't know the exact term. But I'm not sure if those Berryville ones really do, and that's maybe more where I'm seeing that algae. So if you guys ever like contact, you know, the, like say the National Park Service or the local authorities saying, okay, this is a bad algae issue, you guys might have to address it some way or another.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what happens, what we defer to is the state, at least on the New York side of the border, is the state reporting. The DEC has a website and a app where you can report algae blooms. In that particular case, we do have, I mean, the reason NGWASP funds the chlorophyll and phycocyanin sensor, fluorescent sensor there at Calicoon, is because of past harmful algal bloom issues. We don't have a system in place where we would, you know, necessarily notify anybody if there's a threshold crossed. That's not what the purpose of that monitoring site is. I've actually been involved with several harmful algal bloom studies in the Finger Lakes and back when I worked in the Midwest. A lot of the times we defer to the state because each state has its own reporting systems, And a lot of times the states are paying us for these gauges and they monitor them and then issue alerts. Or, you know, a lot of times with these sensors, they'll tell you there's something going on, but it's not enough resolution to say, okay, this is a toxic bloom, for example. So they, it'll at least give them a trigger to send somebody out to collect a sample to be analyzed then for what it is. And that's usually how that works. So, you know, I can provide the DEC link for the New York side. I am not sure what Pennsylvania or New Jersey does as far as harmful algal bloom reporting goes. But I, if you wanted to follow up with me too about, you know, what those sensors are giving you, I'm happy to, you know, have an email dialogue after the fact.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Anything else? Maybe just Jeff's question about silos. There is a question online asking you about the Stilesville problem at Stilesville.
So, yeah, I saw that a couple slides ago, and I, you know, just mentioned that we did recently move that gauge because we had a lot of problems with the stream channel being choked out with weeds and algae mats. I didn't look into that data right before this call, but if somebody wanted to email me after this specifically, I can put you in touch with the site operators and we can tell you exactly what's going on there.
Okay, thank you. We all see these boxes are sitting around and always wonder what they do. Thank you for that information.
Sure thing.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.